Again, John chapter 5, we're going to be in verses 1 through 16 today. So where are we going to go? Well, let me give you a quick vision of where this sermon is going to go. So as we get there, you'll know where we're at. So first of all, we're going to look at John 1 through 4, just very, very quickly. And then we're going to look ahead at John 5 through chapter 7. When Christ asked is going to be the theme of this sermon, how will you answer? Let that kind of resonate in your head for a little bit. So we're going to look at the situation. Go ahead, port it through, Michael. We're going to look at the situation. Then we're going to look at the question. Do you want to get well? We're going to look at the excuse. It's not my fault. We're going to look at the healing. Rise and walk. And then we're going to look at the point. Do you have any idea who Jesus is? And then we're going to follow that up with some application. So I'll kind of give you an idea of where we're going. As we move out of chapter 4 and into chapter 5, let's take a moment just to go back into chapters 1 through 4. And if you recall, those are the chapters that established Jesus as the Messiah. Jesus as the Messiah. The Apostle John purposely tells us of a specific event in these four chapters that point to that statement that Jesus is the Messiah. John the Baptist announces, if you recall in verse 1, Jesus is the Lamb of God. Jesus is the Lamb of God. Then we went on, and Pastor Ricky preached this, that Jesus does his first miracle by turning the water into wine. Mm-hmm. And then later on in chapter 3, he has a discussion about spiritual birth with Nicodemus. And then in chapter 4, we see that Jesus breaks down all the barriers. He breaks down all the walls by speaking to a Samaritan woman. Unheard of. But that's what Christ did. And what he did, he was revealing that he already knew her quite well. That he knew her. By sharing these events, John is demonstrating to us that Jesus is different from everyone else. But as we move into chapter 5, oh, just like some of you teenagers, the mood starts to change. It's not as happy as it was. You see, in chapters 5 through 7, conflict with the religious leaders, it begins to grow. And beginning in chapter 5, we start to see that first trace of rejection of Jesus' actions and his claims. And as we continue into the following chapters, we'll eventually see that it becomes malicious hostility. Malicious hostility. These chapters document the shift from reservation and hesitation about Jesus as Messiah to outright rejection. The opposition started with the controversy regarding Jesus' healing on the Sabbath, which we'll look at today in detail. It intensified in chapter 6 with many of his disciples abandoning him, and finally hardened in chapter 7 into an official opposition against him. And that started with the religious authorities' unsuccessful attempt to arrest him. And accordingly, the theme of the three chapters that we're going to start today is the rejection of Jesus as Messiah. The rejection. Now, that's just a very brief overview of where we've been and where we're going. Obviously, as we preach the sermons in verses 5, 6, and 7, we'll get in more details of what's going on. But that's just a quick overview. This week, we're going to be focusing on John chapter 5, 1 through 16. John chapter 5, 1 through 16. And if you would, stand with me as we read God's holy word. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, a pool, which is called in Hebrew, Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. Now a certain man who had had an infirmity 38 years, and when Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been in that condition a long time, he said to him, Do you want to be made well? The sick man answered, Sir, I have no man to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me. And Jesus said to him, Rise, take up your bed and walk. And immediately the man who was made well took up his bed and walked. And that day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said to him who was cured, It is the Sabbath. It is not lawful for you to carry your bed. He answered them, He who made me well said to me, Take up your bed and walk. Then they asked him, who is this man who said to you, Take up your bed and walk? But the one who was healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had withdrawn, a multitude being in that place. Afterwards, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, See, you have been made well. Sin no more, lest a worse thing comes upon you. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well. For this reason, the Jews persecuted Jesus and sought to kill him, because he had done these things on the Sabbath. May God add to his holy word. You may be seated. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just ask that you be with us as we journey through this passage. Father God, as we examine what was going on in the man's life, Father God, as we examine the power of Christ, and Father God, as we apply it to our lives, Father God, I thank you for allowing me to do the research, for doing the study, and Father God, now I turn it over to you, and just ask that your hand be upon it all. Father God, may it be your words that come out and not my own. And Father God, may you be glorified in all that is done and said. For it's in your Son's blessed and holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let me get personal with you for a second and ask you the question. When Christ asks, Do you want to be well? How will you answer? Think about that for a few moments as we look at this text. Now, Emma and I have been talking a lot lately. And we both agree that it's been a long time since either of us has felt completely well. Now, there's nothing seriously wrong with either of us. We got aches, we got pains, you know, those mysterious ones that pop up. You know, the feet hurting, the knees hurting, the backs hurting, the headaches. So nothing serious, just these little pains. And, you know, we were thinking, it sure would feel nice to feel 100% again. But you know what? I don't think we're alone in feeling that way. I see Trish limping around a little bit today, so we're all in that position. But and most of us over 40 feel that way. Now, before I get myself in big trouble, Emma's not 40 yet. She has a few years to go before she reaches that big 4-0 level. But she's just starting early in her aches and pains, so, which is kind of nice. But when we don't feel good, what do? We want to seek out some kind of treatment or alternative remedies to feel better. For example, for decades, thousands of people trekked out to a place called Evans Plunge in South Dakota, believing that the mineral waters there had healing powers. They believed that if you spent some time in the tepid water, your problems would be washed away. Someone at some point must have claimed healing of something in those springs, and the legend was born. The legend was born. Now, tests were done, and they discovered that the water contained no healing properties whatsoever. Isn't that funny how we like to gravitate to that? Now, on a more personal level, you guys know Jeff's story. I think most of you have heard it. The story of how he was born. But for those of you who don't, let me share with you for a little bit this morning. Jeff was born 3 months premature, and he weighed just 2 pounds even. He was a tiny little thing. He was small enough that they took a preemie diaper and cut it in half and used that. That's how small he was. He spent the first 6 months of his life in a neonatal intensive care unit in St. John's Hospital in Detroit, Michigan. He was on a respirator most of the time. He eventually had to get a tracheotomy just so he could breathe on his own and eventually come home with us. On top of that, he had 2 eye surgeries to reattach retinas in both eyes. And one snowy winter day in Detroit, that this day stands out to me like no other, we got a call from his doctors. And they said they had tried to remove his respirator that morning. And somehow, Jeff didn't respond well to it, and he quit breathing. So they tried to take the respirator, and they put it back. And when they did, they hit something in his throat, a nerve of some sort, and it caused him to have a seizure. And at the same time of all that, he aspirated, because, you know, sucked the stuff in, and he developed pneumonia. Jeff quit breathing that day, and they had to resuscitate him. Em and I were about 30 miles from where the hospital was. We were in our military housing at Selfridge Air National Guard Base, if anybody knows where that's at. Mm-hmm. And when we got the call, they said, don't even try to come in. There's nothing you can do. The roads are too bad. And we just had a huge snowstorm. Huge. Probably normal for Michigan, but for us it was big. And as you can imagine, we did exactly that. We sat around and just waited. No. We spent about 4 hours digging the car out. Our 30-minute trip to the hospital took us about 2.5-3 hours. Listen, if you've never seen a Ford Escort driving in 3 foot of snow, man, you should have been around that day. It was a pretty remarkable sight. The four-wheel drives were passing us, and they're like, what are you guys doing out here? But as parents, staying at home was not an option for us. Our son was hurting, our son was sick, and we had to go see him. But you know, that's not the most amazing event that happened to us. Obviously, Jeff recovered from that and is doing well. But early on in his life, the event that amazed me the most is when the doctor told us that Jeff had developed a bleed in his brain and that it had progressed into a grade 3 bleed, which is the worst you can get. And we were told that the only way to fix it was for them to cut on his head, stick this shunt in his brain so that you can pump the blood out of the brain and into his stomach so it could be relieve the pressure. As you can imagine, we were pretty scared. We were alone in Detroit. We were both very young. Basically, we were on our own. Like I said, we were fearful. Now, before they do a surgery, the doctor said, I'll tell you what, guys. And they had been tracking this. This had been tracked for, a good month or two? And it had gotten progressively worse. So they'd been tracking. And they said, before we do this surgery, let us look one more time so we know exactly where to cut, where to put everything, so we can be exactly sure. We were also told that because of this bleed in his brain, that there was a huge chance he would have some form of cerebral palsy before it was all said and done. So as they prepared to run that test, they did it. And the doctors came back to us a little while later. And he said, it's gone.
Praise God. Praise
God. Em and I looked at each other in disbelief, and the doctor said it again. The bleed has healed itself. It was a grade 3 yesterday. Today it was gone. The doctor said, we're not sure what happened. We saw it yesterday, but now it's gone. And we've never seen this type of condition heal itself like that before. We knew then, and we know even more now, it didn't heal itself. Mm-hmm. The doctors didn't heal it. Mm-hmm. Jeff had a scheduled appointment that morning with a great physician.
Preacher.
And we thank the doctors for using their God-giving talents to take care of our son. But we're not naive enough to think that it was the doctors or the nurses' healing power. But the healing itself came in the power of God. Mm-hmm. Today, for the remainder of our time, we're going to look at another man who was miraculously healed by the power of the great physician as we look at John 5, 1 through 16. And in doing so, we're going to examine, again, the situation. Everyone is sick. Mm-hmm. We're going to look at the question, do you want to get well? We're going to look at the excuse, it's not my fault. We're going to look at the healing, rise and walk. And then we're going to get to the point, do you have any idea who Jesus is?
Help us, preacher.
Let's look at verses 1 through 4 as we look at the situation. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there in Jerusalem by the sheep gate, a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having 5 porches. In these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed,
waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease they had. This pool, again, it's called Bethesda, and it's in Jerusalem. And it had a mystic aura that drew the sick, the lame, the blind, and the paralyzed. Legend said that if a person could slip into the pool when the water was mysteriously rose up, there was a good chance that that person would be healed. It was said that an angel troubled the pool and created this source of healing. At this point, let me point out to you here that it's true that some manuscripts omit the end of John 5:3 and all of verse 4. But it's also true that the event and the man's words in John 5:7 that we'll look at here in just a few minutes would make little sense if these words were eliminated. Why would anybody, especially a man sick for so many years, remain in one place if nothing special was occurring? You would think that after 38 years of nothing happening to anybody, the man would simply go elsewhere and stop hoping. It seems wisest for us to accept the fact that something extraordinarily kept all these sick and handicapped people at the pool, hoping for a cure. And again, the question material in John 5:3, the end of 5:3 and 5:4, it may have been may have been deleted by a copyist concerned about what seemed to be a pagan or superstitious influence. Thus, some biblical scholars argue that maybe that verses 3 and 4 may have been included in the original manuscript. Again, when we get to John chapter 7, and we look at verses 53 through 8:11, which is Jesus dealing with the adulterous lady, the adulterous woman, we're going to examine the authority of Scripture. We're going to get into some more details on that, which I really don't have time to delve in to where we need to be today. So just keep that in your mind as we move forward with this. Archaeologists believe that they found this very pool. I'm not a big archaeologist, but I love when they find biblical stuff. Now, it's not because I need to see it to have faith. And I have faith whether they find it or not.
Yeah.
But I love when the proof is given of what we believe. That just excites me. But back in 1960, they believed that they found this pool with its five colonnades or its five porches. They also found that, like other pools in the area, it was fed by intermittent springs, and that at times water was released in surges from hidden reservoirs in the hills, causing the pools to rise and fall suddenly. Some people may have been healed there, and it only heightened the legend and the hopes of the ill that were there. Now, Jesus walks into the situation, and he picks out one man who had been invalid for 38 years. He could have healed everyone, but he didn't.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus goes to a man who was weak, who was feeble, who was unable to stand because of some wasting disease. Why this one man, you might ask? Jesus was very intentional about this choice. He wanted to reveal something about himself. Now, we might surmise that he wanted to show us God's purpose to deal with human weakness and helplessness. This helpless man does symbolize us in a way. It symbolizes us. We can all see ourselves as weak, in a sense, or helpless, or paralyzed by our past or by our fears, unable to do the things that we want to do in this life. Everyone is sick in one way or another. So let's get to the question. Do you want to get well? And let's look at verses 5 and 6. And it says, "Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lying there, he knew that he had already been in that condition a long time. And he said to him, 'Do you want to be made well?'" Do you want to be made well? Isn't that a strange question to ask? Now, if it was us, we would probably answer it in some very sarcastic way, right? Because that's the way we are. We might say, "I've been saddened by this supposed pool of healing, right? Of course I want to be healed. It's been 38 years. I'm sick of being sick. What do you think?" Right? That's the way we probably would have answered. So why would Jesus ask this? Obviously, it was an important question because it was recorded in Scripture. Do you want to get well? You know, many people honestly don't want to get well.
Amen.
They don't want to be helped. Their helplessness gets them attention that they crave. Their weakness is their excuse for not taking responsibility for helping others. Or for helping others. For this man being healed was most likely frightful. You can imagine that, can't you?
Sure.
He had made a living out of begging. What would he do now if he could walk? Many of the homeless people we meet in the streets of D.C. when we go out and do our mission work actually make a pretty good living through begging. Now, they're not all. I by no means want to say that none of them need our help. But some make a very good living. It takes good skill to get the good dough. Some of those people are probably making more than you and I. They don't want help. It would run business. They need help. Understand that. They need help. But they don't want it. Why? Because change is difficult. Change is difficult. This is in the movie Shawshank Redemption. It's an older movie, but a man had been in prison since he was a teenager. Now at pension age, he was released on parole. But now he faces a huge dilemma. He's been in prison so long, he doesn't know if he can live on the outside. In the apartment they give him, that they give to new parolees, he finds that a man that he knew and that was released earlier had hanged himself there. Now this man faces the same choice. Does he really want to change? Or does he want to go back to the security of prison life? Church, we must admit that there's areas in our life that we know we should change.
That's right.
But we don't really want to.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Our sin serves as a purpose in our life. It keeps us from facing the pain of change. Change is difficult because we don't know what that change will bring to us. Just like the paralyzed man, we will have to choose what we will do with this new life. Do we really want to get well? The question makes us look at the obstacles in our lives. Makes us look at our sins. Makes us look at our problems. It's a lot more difficult to ask, or a lot more difficult to answer than we thought. You might say, but wait, Pastor Wayne, you don't know my situation. You don't know my family. I can't change. I've tried. And that brings us to our third point, the excuse. It's not my fault. Look at verse 7. And the sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me." Perhaps it's true, but in some sense it smacks of an excuse. It's true that he had a desire to be healed, and it's true that he has tried and he lacks the ability to do it on his own. And what he's really saying is, "I've lost all hope." Many here today may feel that way. Feel like there's no hope for change in their situation. You see no way through your own human strength to do this. The 12-step program didn't work. The audio tapes I've been listening to at night were ineffective. The hypnosis, well, that was just a waste of money. They resigned themselves to being weak, faltering Christians. Now, there's no doubt in my mind that you tried. And no one has the right to belittle you for your failing. But it's true of all of us that we can't. Dr. Meredith and Dr. Meyer have written a book about overcoming depression entitled Happiness is a Choice. And they wrote, and let me quote it for you, as psychiatrists, we cringe whenever Christian patients use the words, I can't, and I've tried. Any good psychiatrist knows that I can and I've tried are merely lame excuses. We insist that our patients stop saying can't and say won't instead. They need to see that what they are really doing. So we make them face up to it by saying, I won't get along with my wife or my husband. I won't communicate. I won't discipline my kids the way they should. I won't find time to pray. I won't stop gossiping. And when they change their can't to won't, they stop avoiding the truth and they start facing reality. Man, I thought that was good. Take responsibility and admit that a big part of the reason for your problems is in your own hands.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And in verse 8 and 9, we're going to look at the healing. And the man was told, rise and walk. And Jesus said to him, rise, take up your bed and walk. And immediately the man was made well. He took up his bed and he walked. What Jesus does next seems impossible. He says to the man again, he says, get up, pick up your mat, and take baby steps, right? Pick up your mat and crawl. No, he says, pick up your mat and walk. The thing that this man hasn't been able to do in 38 years. There's three steps crucial to the healing, to this healing that we must be made aware of. The first one is, and it's so simple, do what he tells you. Mm-hmm. Do what he tells you. Jesus tells the man what he cannot possibly do. What he has tried to do for 38 years and failed. Somehow this man sensed that Jesus was going to do something in him that to help him stand. His faith was transferred from himself unto Jesus. Because he knows he can't do it. But he must be able to. He meaning Jesus. If I'm going to get help, if I'm going to be helped, then I must do what he tells me. What that is. Is this what we're missing when we ask God for help? There was always something God tells us to do. Tells us something to believe or to act upon. Let me say that again. There's always something God tells us to believe, to do, or to act upon. Jesus doesn't say, work at it. Jesus didn't tell the man again. He didn't say, start crawling first because you haven't walked, you've got to learn. He doesn't say, okay, I'm going to heal you. But listen, first, build up your faith. He says, get up. He says, get up. We need to do what he tells us, believing that in his will that we do it. Not in our power, but in his will. Secondly, out of these three things, leave no excuse for relapse. Jesus didn't just say, get up. He said, get up and pick up your mat. You think, why did he say that? Jesus didn't want to leave the man any room for relapse. The man could have thought, I'm healed, but I better leave my mat here in case I need to come back tomorrow. The good chance would be, is that he'd be back tomorrow. Jesus leaves no opportunity for that. And in this way, Jesus teaches us that if we want to be healed, that we should not go back to what we have done. This is where we fail. We leave a back door open to sin in our lives. Mm-hmm. Listen, whatever your struggles are, go home and pour your alcohol out if that's your struggle. Get rid of the drugs you're addicted to. Say no to friends who are getting you into trouble. Cut off any possibility of going back to what has sickened you in the first place.
That's good, preacher.
Listen, you always say, don't burn bridges, right? Guys, some bridges in life should and need to be burned.
Right.
Thirdly, walk in his power. The third step, again, it's to walk. The lame man didn't expect anyone to carry him. And you shouldn't expect anyone to carry you. Walk. If Jesus gives you the power to rise, He will give you the power to walk as well. Now these are those three crucial steps are, once again, do what He tells you. Leave no excuse for relapse. And walk in His power. And the fifth point today is the point. Do you have any idea who Jesus is? Let's look at verses 10 through 16. And that day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said to Him who was cured, "It is the Sabbath. It's not lawful for you to carry your bed." He answered them, "He who made me well said to me, 'Take up your bed and walk.'" Then they asked Him, "Who is this man who said to you, 'Take up your bed and walk?'" But the one who was healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had withdrawn, a multitude being in that place. Afterwards, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you have been made well. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you." The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well. For this reason, the Jews persecuted Jesus and sought to kill him, because he had done these things on the Sabbath. This would be just another healing incident, if not for the point Jesus was deliberately making. Whereas the royal official sought out Jesus in the last chapter, you guys recall that? Jesus sought out the invalid in this one. This is just a taste of the differences in this story. The one odd thing really stands out in this story. The man did not know who Jesus was. When the Jews asked who healed him, the man said, "I have no idea." With this healing, Jesus was not randomly acting. He was purposely revealing to everyone present who He was. Two things stand out as we read these verses. One theological, one practical. Theological revelation is this. Jesus was the fulfillment of every Jew's hope. He is the Messiah, the one who would restore unworthy men like this, an invalid, to a relationship with God. Leviticus 21, and verses 16 through 18 says, "No one with any defect shall approach the altar of God." But prophecy foretold of the day when the blind would see and the lame would walk. With few words, Jesus revealed that He was the one sent from God to do this. Jesus also ruffled many feathers by purposely doing this on the Sabbath. No one's supposed to work on the Sabbath, according to the Old Testament law. MacArthur, kind of in his commentary, says this. He says, "The Old Testament forbid work on the Sabbath, but did not stipulate what work was. The assumption in Scripture would be one's customary employment. Whatever you do for a living, that would be considered your work." Mm-hmm. But rabbinical opinion, and that was a lot of that for the Jews, had developed an oral tradition beyond the Old Testament which stipulate 39 forbidden activities, including carrying anything from one place to another. Thus, the man had broken oral tradition, but not the Old Testament law. Note that the Jews didn't ask who healed the man, but who told him to carry his mat. Wow, was that blindness or not? When Jesus told the man to carry his mat, He was saying, now get this, I'm greater than the law. Mercy trumps the law. Jesus is greater than the law or any legalism we can dream up. Think of the symbol of water in these signs. Water is a symbol of the old Judaism. The water of purification in chapter 2 could not produce the joy of the wine. The water failed. The water from Jacob's well in chapter 4 could not quench the thirst of the Samaritan woman. The water failed. The water from the pool of Jerusalem could not heal the lame man. The water failed there as well. What they all needed was not H2O, they needed the living water. The living water never failed. We need the living water.
We sure do. Mm-hmm.
Church, we need Jesus. Do you have any idea who it is that can heal you? Yeah, Jesus. You're going to, it's church. You're going to give me a Jesus answer. You're right. But church, let me ask you, and look me in the eye when I ask you this question. Do you know him? Do you know him? He's not a magic wand that he's going to wave over us and all of a sudden we're going to be well. He's not an MRI machine. He's not a tool to be used when we're in trouble. He is the Lord. And he longs for you to know him. Why? Because he knows you. And he wants to have a relationship with you. We all know the name. Even the demons know the name of Jesus. But do we take the time to know the person of Jesus? Do we know the man who can make us well? Do we have a relationship with the Savior? Now, when we talk about healing, there may be a lot of skepticism and questions that we leave unanswered. Am I saying that if you do the three steps that I mentioned earlier, that you'll be healed as a lame man was? I wouldn't say no. But I don't know what God wants to do in you. Am I saying that we just have to think positive? Positive thoughts. That's all we need. As long as we think that, you'll be healed. Listen, if you got that out of this sermon so far, either you weren't listening, you were daydreaming, or you got an iPod stuck in your ear. Because I'm not saying that at all. Here's a question again. Again, continue to think about it. When Christ asks, do you want to get well? How will you answer? Tony Campolo, he tells a story about being in a church in Oregon where he was asked to pray for a man who had cancer. Campolo prayed boldly for the man's healing. The next week he got a telephone call from the man's wife and she said, you prayed for my husband last week. He had cancer. Campolo thought when he heard her used a past tense verb, had, that the cancer had been eradicated. But before he could think much about it, she said, he died. Campolo said he felt terrible. But she continued, don't feel bad. When he came into that church that Sunday, he was filled with anger. He knew he was going to be dead in a short amount of time. And he hated God. He knew he was going to be dead in a short amount of time. He was 58 years old. And he wanted to see his children and he wanted to see his grandchildren grow up. He was angry that this all-powerful God didn't take away his sickness and healing. He would lie in bed and curse God. And the more his anger grew towards God, the more miserable he was to be for everyone around him. It was an awful thing to be in his presence, she said. But the lady told Campolo, after you prayed for him, a peace had come over him and a joy had come into him. Tony, she said, the last 3 days have been the best days of our lives. We've sung, we've laughed, we've read scripture, we prayed, and oh, they've been wonderful days. And I just called to thank you for laying hands on him and praying for his healing. Then she says something incredibly profound. She said, he wasn't cured, but he was healed.
That's good, preacher.
He wasn't cured, but he was healed. Wellness is more than health, it's wholeness. You may never physically be 100%, but you can be well. Mm-hmm. Jesus can make you well. Do you want to get well? I know that I've included some application as we've gone through this text, but bear with me for a little while longer as we see how to put today's sermon into action. You know, when you come to church, it's easy to only see the surface of what is going on. People are wearing their nice clothes. They got their best smiles on. Everybody looks happy. I hope. It's easy to assume that everything is okay in everybody's life.
Help us, preacher.
But if we're willing to look deeper, we might realize that our seats are filled with with hurting and broken people, even in a church as small as ours. People that need the wholeness that only God can offer. Among us, now, or maybe soon to be in the future, would be families where their income may not match their expenditures, and they soon may be out of money. There are families that face stress day after day. It's the survival of the dysfunctional, as nobody does anything right, and no one is loved. Another has a sickness that they haven't told anyone about. He or she is bearing the burden alone at this moment. Another couple had a nasty fight last night, and each wonders how long the relationship can continue the way it is. Another person struggles with personal sin, to which they are so attracted, they don't think they will ever get away from it. Some of our youth feel like they're being put on a rack and being pulled in both directions. The parents and church are pulled one way and the peers pull the other. Mm-hmm. The brokenness is all over this place. A lousy grade, an unresponsive spouse, a boring job. The stories could go on and on.
That's right.
That's why we say church is to be a hospital for the hurting, not a country club for the saints. The church is full of the lonely, the dying, the discouraged, the addicted, and the exhausted. And we discover that no one is immune to the pains of this cursed humanity. But there is an answer.
There is an answer.
Oh, there is an answer. And the answer is this. Jesus gives wholeness. If the answer is the answer that the man in the story discovered when Jesus chose him, Jesus wants us to experience wholeness. And he can give it to us, not because we deserve it, because we don't, but because of his grace. He desires to give it. For when Jesus looks at us, he does not see a fragment, but he sees us as a whole. He just doesn't give consideration to our body. No, his concern is much bigger. His real concern, get this, church, is your soul. This body's temporary. It's wearing out.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
It's a tent. I love how Paul describes it. It's a tent. But yet, church, we get so focused on this, that we forget about what's in here. But God doesn't. That's what's important to him. You see, Jesus only settles for our possibilities and not what we lack. Hope you recall from earlier as I described Jeff's medical history. Quite frankly, I only touched on the surface then. So Jeff stands in front of you today, a young man who should be blind, who should have cerebral palsy.
Wow.
Who had to have part of his rib cartilage removed so they could just rebuild his throat area so he could breathe. Not to mention several other surgeries and procedures he had to get during that critical first 6 months of life. Church, Jesus is not focused on what Jeff lacked, but instead would only settle for Jeff's possibilities. Mm-hmm. And now God has called him to the mission field to be a servant.
Hallelujah.
He's been to three foreign mission trips already, and he's waiting for the next one that God presents it to him. Jeff could use many excuses why he can't serve, but he doesn't. Church, are you focused on your potential to serve Christ, or are you dwelling on what you're lacking this morning?
I see you, preacher.
Jesus did not give up on the man when he said he could not walk. No, he saw the possibilities that he could walk. And Jesus sees the same for us as well. For without Jesus in our lives, we are helpless invalids in a cruel and unfair world. We are spiritually blind. We are emotionally lame. We are morally paralyzed. But Jesus would have us to rise up from our place of failure, our place of inability, and our place of despair. He would have us take up and move away from that place. He would have us to walk in the newness of life. For us, this means that it's time to get up and walk. For there's wholeness awaiting for us. Church, if you don't know Christ this morning, or if you know Him, but you don't have a relationship with Him, that can change for you today. Do you feel Him tugging at your heart this morning? Will you continue to ignore that call? He's asking you this morning, do you want to get spiritually well? And the question is, how will you answer? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank You for, once again, the opportunity, Lord, just to hear Your Word. Lord, we thank You for the example of the lame man. Father God, how You showed him that he could walk when he quit focusing on himself and he focused on You. Father God, we just ask that You help each of us here today, Father. Lord, that we seek to get spiritually well. Father God, that we seek a new and fresh encounter with You each day. Father God, may we not get caught up in the trap of despair, the trap of hopelessness, the trap of fear. Father God, while the things that we ask may not be answered in the way that we desire, Father God, we know they're answered in the way that You see best. Sometimes it's not a physical healing. Sometimes it's a spiritual healing. And we thank You for that, Lord. And I just pray for those here who are struggling with that today, Lord, that today is the day, Father God, they stop rejecting Your call. And today is the day they respond to Your offer of being made well. For it's in Your Son's blessed and holy name we pray. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.